When I create, you're my muse. The kind of smile that makes the news. Can't nobody throw shade on your name in these streets. Triple threat, you a boss, you a bank, you a beast. You make it easy to choose. You got a mean touch, you can't refuse.
No, I can't refuse it.
Picture perfect, you don't need no filter. Just make them drop dead, you a killer. Shower you with all my attention. Yeah, these are my only intentions. Stay in the kitchen cooking up, cut your own bread. Heart full of equity, you're an asset. Make sure that you don't need no mentions. Yeah, these are my only intentions. Already passed, you don't need no approval. Good everywhere, don't worry about no refusal. Second to none, you got the upper hand now. Don't need a sponsor, no, you're the brand now. You're my rock, my Colorado. Got that ring, just like Toronto. Love you now, a little more tomorrow. That's how I feel, act like you know that you are.
Yeah, I'm just gonna bring them up as they are. So Van, Clara, Christy, Kanye.
This is because I was asked to do it. I admit that in the past I've been a nasty. They weren't kidding when they called me, well, a witch. But you'll find that nowadays I've mended all my ways. Repented, seen the light, and made the switch. True, yes. And I fortunately know a little magic. It's a talent that I always had possessed. Now, I think we all should remember what we talked about this morning. When I say, who dat? Like, oh gosh, fail. Every one of you is not passing this class. No. Food in your mouths. Okay, that works. May burst into show tunes. Yeah, that definitely could happen. So, is everyone enjoying their meal? It's actually super tasty. The mahi-mahi is really good. That mango cheesecake is off the chain. Super tasty. So thank you guys so much for serving us and providing us with delicious vittles. We're going to go ahead and get started on our next session. We're going to bring up our team from TaylorMade. I've got Mr. Vance King. Come on out here, Vince. Woo, yay! Round of applause! Hello, Lumber!
I'm just right here dancing.
That's better. Ricky Miller! You know that I can't get you out. Look at those sleeves, I love those sleeves. Tanya Sutter. And Miss Tawana Carter. TaylorMade, they're all yours.
So everyone, appreciate you sharing your lunch hour with us, so thank you. Usually we get the after lunch, which is not great and ideal, but we have a captive audience, which we love, so thank you for sharing your time with us. We'll dig in here pretty quickly. Just want to thank the Healthcare Advocate Summit for having us, putting on a wonderful show. Good to be back out in public again and at a trade show. So we're just commenting backstage that we're a little bit out of trade show shape. So it'll take us a year or so to get back into the groove of all the meetings and whatever you decide to do at night, that's totally up to you. But anyway, glad to have you guys here. So did a good job of introducing us before we came in. And Clara will do it when we get to the speaker and we have some of our partners up here go through how they attack affordability on a daily basis through a partnership with TaylorMade. To set the stage just a little bit, and this is not new information for any of you, but the reality of it is our patients are struggling to afford healthcare, and that is broad. Across disease states, it is no longer specific to specialty cases or specialty diagnoses. It is broad and pervasive across their healthcare experience. The net of this slide is that they are struggling to pay for it, and it's only getting worse. COVID has impacted some of their ability to receive treatment, receive diagnosis. So there's some of the documentation that you read out there that there is potentially undiagnosed cancer that's going to come in waves coming later because they didn't take the time or the investment to go get diagnoses earlier. So this is only going to get worse for our patients. So as we think about affordability, oftentimes we talk about it in the context of the patient, where he or she is literally sitting around a table, much like you are right now, thinking about, do I pay my rent or do I pay for my medication? Do I pay my mortgage? Do I go to work? Or do I support my family member who has to get transportation to his or her treatments? These are real conversations that are happening. And much of the time we spend focusing on that piece of affordability, but its impact is broad. There's also a provider out there thinking about, how do I get my patient on therapy more quickly as he or she struggles with financing their healthcare? There are pharmacists out there thinking about, how do I reduce my drug spend and under the pressures of margin compression and those types of things as my providers and patients struggle with healthcare, right? There are healthcare executives out there thinking, how do I participate in my value-based contracts as my patients struggle mightily with healthcare, and how do I provide them tools and assistance and pervasive across diagnoses, regardless of disease state, so that I can help them and help my bottom line. So as we think about our collective mission at TaylorMed, really it is to directly impact affordability. Can we remove dollars from the out-of-pocket costs for our patients? That is our number one focus. And if we do that correctly, it allows us to proactively identify patients for assistance. And that assistance is disease state agnostic, right? So it's not just oncology. It's not just those specialty conditions that have historically gotten the lion's share of the focus. There is a need at a retail setting to look for, can I help that patient with the entirety of their meds across an encounter? And if we do that right, we have the ability to serve patients, and we have the ability to serve them broadly. So as we think about how we do this, right, it no longer are we able to take a siloed approach to it and only think about a service line. We have to think about a network. And you'll hear us at TaylorMed refer to the network, right? So that's life science partners, it's our providers, it's our patients. Can I engage the patient directly in their assistance? Can I put that in their hands to be able to allow them to drive outcomes? Can I get the life science partners to allow us to effectively shorten the enrollment cycle? We said a conversation earlier about, can we standardize some of these enrollments, and how do we think about the data that's required to facilitate an easier process to get patients engaged and allow them to engage in assistance more simply? And I see the panel nodding their heads as they've been doing this for a while. So as you'll think about this, and so we're the good fortune here to part of our network here on stage, and they're going to go through sort of how they think about assistance, how they're facilitating the workflows, and some of the great outcomes that they're having. So again, thank you, and Claire, I'll hand it over to you.
Thank you, Vince. So I'm Clara Lambert. I'm the Director of Financial Navigation with TaylorMed, and I've had the opportunity to spend some time with these three ladies. They're leaders in financial navigation. They also have worked on developing processes to include technology into their financial navigation programs. And since we've not been doing trade shows for a while, my glasses are not as strong as they should be, maybe. I'm gonna let let you read all the statistics and just do the introductions. So we have Tanya Suter from Mary Bird Perkins. We have Christy Miller from Bon Secours, and we have Tawana Carter from Advocate Aurora Healthcare. So we chose these just because they're all at three different levels of, you know, where they are in their program and how they brought it to leadership and project management and how incorporating this technology into their processes was important. So first of all, getting buy-in from executive leadership, and I think that's something that I've heard just from my colleagues a lot, you know, like, we who are in the field doing the work, we need help. How do we get buy-in from our leadership? So I'll let Tanya get started with that.
Good afternoon. I'm Tanya Suter. I'm with Mary Bird Perkins Cancer Center, just up the road in Baton Rouge. And we started our patient assistance program probably about 5 years ago. and it's evolved and it's changed in all those 5 years. But when I came to the cancer center, I was the patient access manager, and I decided, you know, there has to be something out here to help these patients with their out-of-pockets. And I started asking around. I went to a conference and heard about, you know, all the patient advocacy, and met TaylorMed first time out of the gate. And I thought, wow, this is much better than a spreadsheet, you know, because that's kind of my thought of what we would use to track everything. So as they say, you know your audience. And I knew that I would have to go to our administrator, whose background was social work. And I would have to go to our VP of operations, whose background was finance. So I thought, okay, I got this. I'm going to pull on heartstrings on one, and I'm going to pull on the finance side to the other. So I went to the administrator first, and I said, hey, what can we do to help the patients with the bottom line? You know, we have a lot of outstanding AR. We're writing off things to bad debt, and we're doing a lot of things in authorizations and other things to recover money, but, you know, there's still this need for these cancer patients. And so we talked about it. I said, okay, there's tons of things out there, the drug companies, there's foundations based on diagnoses and so many things. So let's just go ahead and, you know, start doing this. And she said, oh, that sounds great. What do I need to do? And then I went to the finance guy, and I had all my numbers to say what our AR was, what the recovery could be, you know, based on some of the information TaylorMed had given me and then some of my colleagues. And I said, okay, this is how it's going to affect our bottom line and bad debt. And he was like, sign us up now. So I had really good advocates, and that's important. But again, know your audience. So present to your higher-ups kind of in their lane of what they, you know, are wanting to achieve with their piece of the cancer centers or facility.
I would 100% agree. however, we are a mission-based, faith-based hospital, so it was a little bit easier for us. I knew exactly who I needed to go to based off of that. We actually presented missed opportunities from patients and ROI, and once we did that, it was easy to tie in patient and physician satisfaction. So we actually wanted our goal to expand our services. So we had been doing patient assistance for almost 10 years, doing it manually, which is very cumbersome for not only us as leaders for reporting, but also for the financial navigators.
Tawana, do you have anything to add here?
Yeah, I would agree. We had a similar approach from a system perspective. We also wanted to look at patient-centered care. We understand that new cancer treatments were continuing to go up, you know, for new regimens and for those patented drugs as well as the generic drugs. We knew that the impact on our patients for treatment and for the healthcare system were continuously going up. And the effect of that was actually driving the combination therapies that patients were now participating in. Patients were receiving multiple drugs simultaneously. They were on active treatment for longer periods of time, and this was creating a financial hardship for our patients. So we took the same workflow, created an SBAR, presented all of this information, the financial aspect and savings for the patient, as well as the well-being of the patient as well. So I would totally agree. That's how we proceeded, and it worked out very well.
All right, so now you've gotten buy-in from your executive leadership, and now it is time to implement the product. So I'm gonna get started with Tawana on this. Tell us a little bit about implementing a technology product. You worked with not just one cancer center, but a whole healthcare system that was going through some major changes.
Yeah, so we always talk about change, right? We're always in the state of change, and we're always moving. So across Illinois and Wisconsin, we had to come up with a strategy. My thing is always have a really clear strategy. Understand the priorities. We want to create savings for the patient, for the organization, but we also want to focus on access to care, care compliance for the patient. All of these had a component included in that. So we created a team. We had clear priorities or clear vision. involve operations in that work, because they're on the front lines, they're going to have to do the work. And after you have that clear vision, create a team of super users, because you can't be everywhere at the same time, right? And you have to get buy-in and ownership, right? Involve people in the decision making, and everybody, our organization is very driven around patient-centered care, our mission, our values. We put the patient first. And after you have those clear priorities, what is the goal? What are we trying to accomplish for the patients, for the organization? And the rest, I don't want to say it's going to be easy. It's going to be challenging. You're going to have to develop your workflows. You're going to have to do training and education and provide that ongoing support. But that is really, really our success story. And we're doing very well across both states.
So, Christy, you've got 6 states?
Almost, yeah.
Yeah, so tell us about implementing through that.
Prayer. No, it was pretty seamless once we actually got to the ministry part, because we were wanting to work with our Vibar. We actually started with Vibar to create a pilot site, because we didn't want too big of a bite. So we actually created a pilot site, which ID'd our stakeholders, our processes, and our users. So once we actually got to the entire ministry, it was like a breath of fresh air. We're like, we can finally use it. Yes. And then when we rolled it out, we started seeing value, and that was really easy for us to implement in other areas within our ministry once we actually started that. But I will say we utilized our financial navigators and our users that were in the pilot site for the change management through the entire system. Because let's face it, healthcare is change and people hate change. So if we get those who say, yes, we're doing great, we can actually see this and it makes my job easier, it's a whole lot easier for that implementation throughout the entire ministry.
And how about you, Tanya?
Well, I've implemented twice because the first time we implemented, we were with our health system. And I say learn to know your IT folks, because the IT folks are important for this implementation. We had a, for the partnership that we had with the healthcare system, they had a remote IT people. We didn't have the same person every time. They changed then team leads sometimes for the project, and it was a nightmare. So make sure you're in good with your IT team. And then, so we implemented that. We finally got going. 6 months later, we decide, oh, we're not going to be part of this health system anymore. We're going to go with OneOncology out of Tennessee. And in January of 2022 this year, we switched again. So then we had to back off of our feed. It was a new EMR system, so we started all over. And thank goodness my IT system, my IT team is in-house. So that was great. Because I could say, you're doing this today. Well, let's get it done. But again, building a strong implementation team, some super users, you know, making sure everybody has a role that they feel like, okay, this is the role that I need to make sure is working. And what's great is, along the way, we have our customer support team with TaylorMed, and I can call them and say, hey, this has like a little, can you tweak this just a little bit to make it do this because we like this? And they can do that for us. And they probably do that for Christy, and they probably do that for Tawana. So that's nice that you can kind of customize it to your practice.
I would agree with that. I think the support team from the vendor was very, very supportive. I think they joined our work team. The work team included leadership as well as our HIT people, our clinical informatics people as well. But the support team from Viver was just exceptional. I mean, the educational materials, they were on site to help us roll out and implement it. It was just amazing. So we had a very, very smooth implementation.
Who would you say would be valuable team members for an implementation team?
I would say you're going to have to engage your leaders, right? You're going to have to engage your operational leaders. I think HIT is very important, having super users, but everybody needs to know about the product. You have your social workers in there, your financial navigators, all of those key people that are going to be touching that patient and know that those resources are available, as well as your physicians. and your advanced practice nurses should also be involved.
Do you have anybody to add to that, Christy?
I would say involve pharmacy.
Yep.
Pharmacy. One of the biggest, our biggest supporters is pharmacy because of the benefit we show them for our savings for their pharmacy. But in addition, actually have leaders in there. Let them look and be transparent about what you're doing, because if you can report ROI and they can pull it up at any time, they're on it. They love it. And then they can also see exactly what patients we're touching and what we're doing. So there's not any question about what our financial navigators are doing for our advocacy.
Yeah. Tanya, you have anybody to add?
Yeah, I agree. IT, pharmacy. Those are the two folks. If you get them on board, you're golden.
All right, so top priorities for financial navigation. I think we probably, there's a lot of them. So let's, Christy, you want to get started? Tell me a little bit about the priorities your team has.
Yeah, so first I would say no matter what program you go with, that you always align it with your ministry, with their mission and values, because that is how you get leadership support. So we always made sure that was our top priority for our financial navigators. But we look through the patient through the entire journey, holistically looking at what would benefit them. So we do that through insurance optimization, copay, and then if we needed free drug. So, but as a leader, I will definitely say the top priority for our financial navigators is standardization and training. And thank goodness for our team, because they did provide that training for our navigators when we went live with Vibar. Let's face it though, I mean, it is very, very hard to have financial conversations with patients. It is very hard. They just got their diagnosis, they just talked to a team, they talked to social work, and now we're saying, this is how much you owe. So to have something and a tool to kind of help guide that conversation is essential. So we want every tool available that we have to help guide that conversation.
Tanya, what would you say your top priorities for your financial navigation program is?
Engaging our providers. Again, pharmacy. You know, there's a lot of biosimilars out there right now. And we got very nervous when biosimilars came on board, because that took away some of the drug copay programs. And so we were like, wait, stop. We know that it saves the bottom line for the company, and there's rebates and all of these great things. But if we've already got this patient that's on a lifetime of whatever drug, and they can stay on that program, then can we still please prescribe that? You know, they've been doing well on it. There's no reason for the change to the biosimilar, because it may not help our bottom line, but it helps that patient's bottom line. And is that the mission? That's the mission, to help the patient first. So.
Tawana, how about for Advocate Aurora?
Well, just to focus on early interventions, right? Being more proactive than reactive. And we've really tried to focus on standardization, making sure we have standardized workflows across both states, across all of our practices and disciplines that are using the tool.
Sounds good. I keep hearing standardized workflows, I think, from all three. All right, so now that we've got a financial navigation in progress, you've got your financial navigators working with good processes, but you still always want to improve. So what would you say your tips for increasing approvals, you know, getting your team a little, you know, to dig in a little further? Tanya?
We always work from the top down, so the highest dollar first, whatever drug or copay assistance program we can get with the most bang for our buck first, and if, you know, get them, the patient, enrolled in that, and then go to the next thing. Okay, so is the next thing that they need is housing. Well, then we pass that off to our social work team, who also have logins and understand how to use the program, and then they go in and sign them up for that. Do they need transportation? Do they need some of the other things? So we got the big hitter first, and then everything kind of trickles down. And we just try to be a good steward of everyone's funds.
So, you know, if we have them signed up with a big health well grant, well, then we try to do some of the smaller funds that go straight to the patient other than coming to the revenue of the facility or the cancer center. You know, so good steward of the funds is also important.
Yeah, I definitely agree with that.
Absolutely.
Tawana, what has your team done to increase approvals?
I think we've tried to focus on what's available for our patients outside of the box, what, you know, travel funds or other things, external programs that can be supported. I think that's been our main focus.
How about your team, Christy?
So I think there's actually two things that actually increase approvals. One of them is training with the navigators. Know your insurance requirements. What are the step edits? What are your pharmacy formularies? What are your site of service requirements? Because if you don't know that, then you can't have a good, effective program for your financial navigators. But I would say through the platform, it has been really easy through our work list. Having that standard process so they can do what they need to do on a daily basis is very helpful. Navigators can't do everything in one day. I don't expect them to. But let's prioritize their day so they can really look at what is needed for all the patients. So if I can focus in on my self-pay patients today, and then tomorrow look at my Medicare patients, and then so on and so on, so I can really prioritize what is actually happening in our center for our patients, and we would need to do that. I would also say another way to increase approvals is looking at those wait lists. Thank you. Foundations that have that, because that is essential for us. If it's not open, to really, really look at that. And your platform actually alerts us when a wait list is open, or when it's there, or when a foundation is open for a certain disease state. So looking at those and utilizing those work lists has increased our approvals.
I can also add that we work with Viber to create automatic enrollments. For patients, that's been really helpful for us as well. So that has really, really been key. It's made a really big difference.
Yeah, so you would say the automation portion.
Absolutely. The more you can automate it and not, you know, be so manual, the better.
Definitely agree with that. Okay, so we have three successful programs up here that represented. So tell me about the elements that you think make your team most successful. Tanya?
That they optimize using the software. You know, people get into habits of using the pieces that they like and that they know instead of going outside of their comfort zone and, oh, what does this button do? What does this menu do? And I think, you know, make sure they have continual training, which is, again, provided by our support team at TaylorMed and Vibor. So, you know, ask the questions. Okay, how are you utilizing this software? Do you like it? What do you not like about it? What are you comfortable with? What's your favorite part? What's your least favorite part? And just kind of get that from each of the stakeholders that are using the software.
Christy?
I think we have a really great and successful program. In 2021, we brought in $35 million worth of free drug, and this year we're actually on track to actually increase that. But it is essential for a successful program to adapt and to adjust where we need. So we're really looking at adjusting ours to other areas with inside of our ministry. So going out to the medical practices instead of just in the infusion practices. We're looking at financial navigator cross-coverage because, again, we want to look at our bottom line for the hospital system and make sure that we're reaching every patient, and getting that ROI and that data is really helpful for us. Again, customization that y'all allow for us. It is great for our reporting and for our leadership because I can look at my specialty practices, I can look at my medical practices, and I can look at my infusion, all three separate entities, but then I can combine them when I'm at the ministry level and say, this is what we're doing across the ministry. And I can do it per facility, which is actually great for our success for our program because it allows us to see opportunities for improvement and where we're missing some of our outreach.
Tawana?
Yes, I agree with all of what Tanya and Christy have stated. We're, you know, again, we're focused on early interventions. We are creating reports for all new cancer patients with new diagnoses to try and identify what support or programs may be available for those patients, capturing patients from multiple channels, you know, hardwiring those checkpoints, really helping to educate our patients, making sure they understand their benefits, optimizing, continuing to optimize patient coverage. We are also working to expand. So we're working on those patients that are transferring from inpatient to outpatient chemotherapy. We are expanding our pharmacy, PAP, MAP programs. We are expanding past oncology. We're looking at other specialties, you know, because most of our infusion centers, we capture patients not just for oncology, for other specialties. So we are really looking forward to, I think we are going to double our savings over the next year. So we're looking really forward to all of those.
That's really great. Yeah. All right, so we have successes, but there's also lessons learned. So I see some smiles up here. Yeah, as we go along implementing, you know, financial navigation and technology, there's always lessons that you've learned along the way. And I think it's valuable to share those too. So I'll put it right back at you.
All right, right back at me. So I think it's really important to have engagement. Have those partners that are engaged buy in. You know, they're not renters, they're owners. And streamlining through integration. I think you work past the issues, you create your work team, you have your post huddles, you have your daily huddles to support your patients. Your navigators should know as much about the patients as they can to be able to support those patients and families. And always be ready for change and growth. If something doesn't work, then we can change it. But I think our support from Viber was really, really excellent. I can't say enough about that. So I think those are lessons learned along the way for me.
Christy, what would you say the top lessons you learned along your process?
Well, healthcare and advocacy is a change in itself and a challenge. I mean, it is mind-boggling every day how much it changes, and we need to be ahead of that. How do we do that as leaders? That is really a challenge in ourselves, but I think the past 2 years of the pandemic has really highlighted this for us in our advocacy world. It has thrown us for a loop. What do we do? How do we reach these patients? Where are these patients coming from? I mean, we've seen an increase in our patients that we've never seen before. Not only that, we've seen an increase in self-pay patients, patients who could not pay their premiums, patients who have never came to the hospital before, not knowing what to expect. Now they're saying, oh, here it is. So we were forced to change. We were forced to change our outlook. So we developed a proactive strategy, knowing that it may change. and that was okay. And knowing that was okay has been a lesson for us. And I guess we've also, as leaders, we've kind of changed our mentality of from the top down. We are actually moving from our financial navigators, letting them be a part of the strategy and letting them to say, these are the processes that we need to implement to make sure that we actually advocate for our patients. Instead of us telling them what they need to do, they recognize it. They're with the patient every day. So listening to them and implementing that has been a great lesson for us.
Tanya, how about your team?
I would say choosing the employees that are going to work this system. You have to have heart. You have to have compassion and passion for getting these programs. It should be exciting every time you get an approval that says they're approved and that we're going to cover this amount of dollars. I want somebody that, you know, in their mind, they may not scream it out loud, and if they did, it would be fine, to say, yay, I got it, yeah, you know, and to call that patient and say, okay, we've got this assistance. So I say start with the people that are going to implement your programs first, to make sure they have the passion for it, and that they continue the passion, because, you know, it's exciting maybe at first, but because of all the changes, because of all of the stakeholders you have to go to, of all the things we need to learn, I mean, you need to know your insurance marketplace. That alone is difficult. That roadmap is I mean, we were, you know, some of the sessions we were in yesterday, I'm like, oh, I didn't even know that, you know, certain things about insurance and the games they can play. So I just think that it starts with the person that's working it and knowing your marketplace.
And Clara, can I just add, for us, you know, time was a critical component for us at Advocate Oral Health. We were so focused on patient compliance to treatment, eliminating delays in treatment, increasing access, and also team member productivity. So all of these things surrounded by time, which would impact the patient and our team members, were something we really, really focused in on, and we learned a lot from that, being able to improve and increase those workflows.
That's great. Thank you. All right. So thank you very much for joining us. We have some time for questions. And I'm sure, is there somebody out there running around with microphones?
There is someone out here running around with a microphone.
All right. So if you want to raise your hand if you have a question, the microphone will find you.
Yes, it will find you.
Well, I have one if I can, real quick.
Oh, great. Thanks. Yeah.
You know, we've gone through a lot of sort of how we prioritize within sort of when we have a program or the approval to move forward with it. But for organizations that see the opportunity, right, we all want to help patients. How did you go about ensuring that the program was aligned to overall objectives, right? So we're all fighting for dollars. We're all fighting for IT prioritization. They're mostly good ideas that we want to go implement across the health system. How do you think about prioritizing and tying it to the broader so that folks can go, if they're having trouble getting it prioritized in their organization with IT or something like that, how did you guys sort of tie it to the overall objectives?
I think making sure that you tie it into the patient continuation journey and making sure that you're looking at it from start to finish. And if you hit a snag, as in IT, saying what this is doing, what you're creating is causing a delay. So let's try to do something to fix that. And everyone in healthcare, we're here to help. We're here to advocate for our patients, no matter if you're the CEO to all the way down to the registration person and that person sitting at the front desk. We want to help our patients. So what can we do to make sure that that's aligned? And I think the program has allowed us to see that, and when we implemented it, giving that ROI and saying this is what we're doing to help our patients has really been instrumental for us.
Yeah,
I would agree with that. Aligning with our mission for how we take care of our patients and help our patients live well. You know, we started with an SBAR. You know, we really brought the problem and then the recommendation, here's how we can solve this issue for our patients. You increase access, you increase adherence and compliance, you have better outcomes for your patients, and it's what we all want. So I think that's the, you know, the right approach to take.
I just say that it's a piece of the patient journey. As much as that same referral that got them the consult, that got them, you know, the first lab appointment, then the first infusion appointment, it's, you slide this part in as the piece of the patient journey that they have to do it. So it's as simple as, oh, rooming the patient and getting, you know, their vitals. Well, if your piece, your IT piece is broken there, you'd fix that really quick, wouldn't
right.
you?
Right?
Because I can't get my blood pressure and I can't get whatever. So you just make this piece as a part of that journey that's seamless. It is something that happens along with the consult and along with the infusion appointments, along with whatever appointments they have going on.
And I would like to add that we actually incorporate our patient with VIBAR. So we are printing out the matches. We're saying, this is what's available to you. This is our suggestions to you. But what do you think? Why do you want to go with this foundation? Why do you want to go with this free drug? Do you rather change your treatment? What do you want? And we actually bring that to them, and to have that availability in front of them is, like I said, we're trying to go remote. If we're showing that on a computer screen or if we're printing that out and putting that in front of them, that has been a big help too, because patients now are involved in their financial decisions, where we have never really, prior to 10 years ago, we were not doing that. It was just, this is what it is, and hope for the best. Now they're actually being proactive with their treatment financially, and this program allows us to be a part of them, to be a part of that conversation with us.
That's an interesting tag, because they're actually expecting it, the patient, mm-hmm. right? One thing coming out of COVID is we're all more comfortable with our devices, and I wouldn't say we're active participants in our healthcare yet. We're not quite there yet, but we are willing to engage in some things, so that's a really interesting point.
Yeah. I do have a question from online.
Okay.
This is from Lauren. She asks, can you speak more about step therapy? My son, we fight every year for Remicade, which saved his life. After being on for 5 years, they started step letters. We are in a savings program and pay $5 for everything. I spent 2 months this year. Problem is that if you want to increase a dose above the standard, which is all chronic patients, then they force you to take a biosimilar. I fight every year. It's awful.
So I see Tanya shaking her head. So Tanya, I'm going to let you take this one.
Well, I mean, we appeal to step therapy. We say, no, they've been on this. They need to stay on this. We have the physician write a letter that we submit and say, we can prove that you don't need to change this patient's medicine. There's a reason they've been on it. You know, but we do the opposite as well. So if the patient is not doing well on a medication and they have assistance, and we know if they change it's going to be possibly some more out of pocket, then we go another route. Okay, go ahead and change them, and let's find what we can do to affect that bottom line now. So again, the patient is at the forefront. They're in the center of the room. What is best for them, you know? And you make sure that the providers and, you know, you do your best with the insurance companies to follow suit.
I would like to add, make sure that you are engaged with your insurance company. Patients have the ability to appeal decisions. It's not just the healthcare provider. So go out there, give them the tools to appeal that, because sometimes hearing the patient perspective allows for the insurance to kind of say, not only am I hearing from the physician, but the patient actually wants this. This is what they are wanting because they have been on this treatment for so long. So give them the tools to actually call the insurance company to say, why are you doing this? And if we can't, then we look at free drug for the drug that they were previously on to maintain that treatment. So.
All right, so we have just over a minute left. Do we have any other questions? All right, I'll take the quiet. We really want to thank you very much.
Here's one question.
Oh, we do have a question.
I just had a question. How can we see a demonstration of how the system works?
Can you repeat that in the microphone, please?
Yeah, I would love to see a demonstration of how the software works, because I think it would help those of us who are providers consider purchasing it.
Yeah, I'm going to pass that one over to Vince.
Yeah, absolutely. So I could either touch base with you directly afterwards, or you can stop by the booth, and we'd be happy to talk through it.
Once you see it, you're going to want to use it. So
yeah.
Really.
Yeah. I was going to say you'll want to take
it
home.
You're going to love it.
All right. Well, any other questions? All right. Thank you very much for joining us for lunch today. We really appreciate the time you gave us. Again, you are welcome to stop by the booth, like Vince said. We can work out demos, answer any other questions that you have, and these ladies will be here at the conference too, so if you have any additional questions, be happy to talk to you further.
I thank the three of you for, thank you very much.
Thank
appreciate
you.
Your expertise and your partnership.
Oh, come on, you guys can do better than that. Oh, I thought he was going to drop a beat for me. I was like, let's go, baby. Thank you guys so, so much. We really appreciate you. Oh, I love your little owl.